Hey friends, welcome to the YouTube channel All About Electronics. So in this video, we will talk about the amplitude modulation and particularly, we will learn about the double sideband suppress carrier. So this amplitude modulation is a one form of carrier communication. And before we jump into this amplitude modulation, we should be aware about the two types of communication. The one is the baseband communication and the second one is carrier communication. And first of all, let us briefly talk about the baseband communication. So in the baseband communication, the message signal is transmitted without any kind of modification. And here, the term baseband signal is used for the original message signal which is generated from the source itself. For example, in the telephony, this audio signal is the example of the baseband signal and it contains the frequencies from 0 to 3 kHz. And because of the low frequencies, this baseband signal cannot be transmitted over the radio link because at low frequencies, the height of the antenna would be very high. So in a baseband communication, each user is allocated a different channel such as a coaxial cable or the twisted pair cable. Because if such signals are transmitted simultaneously, then there will be an interference between the each signal. Because in case of the audio signal, the audio spectrum of each user contains the similar range of frequencies. And because of that, if you see, the frequency band of each user will overlap with each other. So using the modulation, the frequency spectra of the baseband signal can be shifted to the non-overlapping band at the high frequencies. And the communication, which uses the modulation to shift the frequency spectra of the message signal, is known as the carrier communication. And for this frequency shifting, the high frequency carrier signal is used. So this carrier signal does not carry any information, but it helps in carrying this message signal. So basically, it acts like an envelope. Now, if you see this carrier signal, then basically there are three properties. That is amplitude, frequency and the phase. So in this carrier modulation, any of the three basic properties of this carrier signal, such as the amplitude, frequency and the phase, is changed according to the baseband signal. And particularly in this amplitude modulation, the amplitude of the carrier signal is changed according to the message signal. And further, depending on the frequency spectra of the modulated signal, the amplitude modulation can be further classified into the four categories. First one is double sideband suppress carrier, which is commonly known as the DSB-SC. Then the second one is the double sideband with the carrier signal. And conventionally, it is known as the amplitude modulation. Then the third one is the single sideband modulation and the fourth one is the vestigial sideband modulation. So in this particular video, we will learn about the DSB-SC, that is the double sideband suppress carrier. And in the upcoming videos, we will also learn about the different modulation schemes. So let's say this MT is the message signal or the baseband signal and this cos 2πf0t is the carrier signal. So as I said, in the amplitude modulation, the amplitude of the carrier signal is the linear function of the message signal. Now if the amplitude of the carrier signal is made directly proportional to the message signal, then the modulated signal can be represented like this. And for simplicity, we can assume that this phase phi is equal to 0. So this is the expression of the modulated signal for the DSB-SC. Now in the previous videos, we have already seen the frequency shifting property of the Fourier transform. So let's say the Fourier transform of the message signal MT is equal to MF. Now if this signal is multiplied with the carrier signal, that is cos omega naught t or the cos 2πf0t, then its Fourier transform can be given by this expression, right? So first of all, let us see its frequency spectrum. So let's say this one is the frequency spectra of the message signal. And whenever it is multiplied with the carrier signal cos omega naught t, then the entire spectrum will get shifted to the frequency f0. So here we are assuming that the bandwidth of the baseband signal is equal to b. But since we are representing this signal using the Fourier transform, so in the frequency spectrum, we are also getting this negative frequency band, that is from 0 to minus b. But when we modulate this signal, then the bandwidth of the modulated signal is equal to 2b. So the modulated signal is centered around the plus minus F0 frequency, and for the positive side of the spectrum, it contains the frequencies from F0 minus B to F0 plus B. That means its bandwidth is equal to 2B. Similarly, if we see the negative side of spectra, then the message signal varies from minus F0 minus B to minus F0 plus B. So the frequency spectrum that is on the right hand side of the F0, that is from F0 to F0 plus B, is called the upper sideband. Similarly, the frequency band on the left hand side of the F0 is called the lower sideband. Now, although this upper and the lower sideband carries the same information, but unfortunately in this modulation, both bands are transmitted together. So as you can see, this modulation scheme requires the twice the bandwidth of the modulating signal. Now in this type of modulation, there is a no discrete component at the frequency F0, because if such frequency component is present, then it would be represented by the delta function or the impulse function at the frequency F0. So in this modulation scheme, since both upper and the lower sidebands are transmitted, and since there is a no discrete carrier frequency at the F0, so this carrier modulation is known as a double sideband suppressed carrier. So in this type of modulation, the carrier frequency F0 should be greater than or equal to the maximum frequency of the message signal. And in this case, it should be greater than or equal to B. That means if B is the bandwidth of the modulating signal, then the carrier frequency F0 should be greater than or equal to B. Because if the carrier frequency is less than the B, then the two copies of the message signal spectra will overlap with each other and the message signal will be lost during the modulation. So to avoid this type of overlapping, the carrier frequency should be greater than or equal to B. Alright, so now let us see the time domain representation of this modulated signal. So if MT is the modulating signal or the message signal, and the cos omega naught t or the cos 2 pi f naught t is the carrier frequency, then the modulated signal will look like this. Now one thing if you notice over here, then at every zero crossing of this message signal, there will be a phase reversal in the modulated signal. Alright, so now let us see how to generate this modulated signal for this DSB-SC. So this modulation is basically a multiplication of the carrier signal and the message signal. So if we have a multiplier IC, and if we apply the message signal and the carrier signal as an input to it, then at the output, we can get the modulated output. Now in the early days, when the multiplier ICs were not readily available, then using the other techniques, the modulated signals were generated. But we will talk about those techniques in the separate video. But nowadays, using this multiplier IC, it is possible to generate this modulated signal. Now in a special case, when the modulating signal contains only a single frequency, like a pure sinusoid, then this type of modulation is known as the tone modulation. So let's say in this tone modulation, the frequency of this modulating signal is equal to FM. And if we see the modulated signal, then it is basically a multiplication of the two sinusoids. And further, it can be simplified like this. So now, let us see the frequency spectrum of this modulating as well as the modulated signal. Now, if you are aware, then using the Euler's identity, this cos 2 pi fm t can be expressed as the summation of the two complex exponentials, right? And using the frequency shifting property of the Fourier transform, we can find its Fourier transform. So if we see the Fourier transform, then it contains the two delta function or the two impulse functions that is located at the fm and the minus fm. So this will be the frequency spectra of the cosine wave of the frequency fm. And after the modulation, we will get these two terms. That means after the modulation, this entire spectrum will get shifted by the positive frequency F0 on the positive side and by minus F0 on the negative side. That means after the modulation, we will get the four frequency components. Now here, if we see the Fourier transform of this first term, then we will get the two impulse function that is located at this frequency F0 plus FM and the minus F0 minus FM. Similarly, if we see the Fourier transform of this second cosine term, then it contains the two impulse functions, which is located at the f0 minus fm and the minus f0 plus fm. So in this way, we get the four frequency components after the modulation. So this is the frequency spectra of the modulated signal in case of the tone modulation. Alright, so now let us see at the receiver end how to demodulate this signal and how to retrieve the message signal from this modulated signal. So once again, using the multiplier along with the low pass filter, it is possible to retrieve the message signal. So for the multiplier, the one input will be the received modulated signal and the second input will be the locally generated carrier signal. And the frequency of this carrier signal should be equal to f0. So let's say the multiplied output is equal to E of t. And when it is passed through the low pass filter, then we can retrieve the message signal. So let us see how. So after the multiplication, the output can be written as mt times 1 plus cos of 2 pi times 2 f0 t divided by 2. That is equal to mt divided by 2 plus mt divided by 2 times cos of 2 pi times 2f0 t. That means after the multiplication, we will get the two terms. So to understand this demodulation process better, let us take the Fourier transform. So the Fourier transform of the first term will be equal to mf divided by 2. Well, if we take the Fourier transform of the second term, then it is equal to 1 by 2 times m of f minus 2f0 plus 1 by 2 times m of f plus 2f0. So basically, this term is the modulation of the signal mt by the carrier frequency 2f0, right? And if you see the overall frequency spectrum of this multiplied signal, then it will look like this. So if we pass this signal through the low pass filter, then the modulated bands at the high frequencies will get removed. And at the output, we will get the message signal that is equal to 1 by 2 times mt. So in this way, it is possible to demodulate the received signal. So as you can see, using this Fourier transform analysis, it is easy to analyze the signal in the frequency domain. And that is why it is necessary to have some background of this Fourier transform. So this type of demodulation is known as the synchronous or the coherent demodulation, because the carrier signal of the same frequency and the phase which is used for the modulation is also used for the demodulation. So for this type of demodulation, the locally generated carrier should be in a synchronization with the carrier of the modulated signal. And because of all these needs, the complexity of the receiver increases. Because when the transmitted signal is received at the receiver, then it might have traveled the long distance. And because of this, the signal could have suffered the frequency and the phase shift. So if we see the received signal after the long distance communication, then it would look like this. So here, this A is the attenuation, while this TD represents the some time delay in the received signal. And here, this delta F is the frequency shift. Or alternatively, we can write this expression in this fashion, where this phase phi D is equal to 2 pi times f0 plus delta F times TD. So in this coherent demodulation, the local oscillator should be able to generate this frequency from the received signal, which not only increases the cost, but also increases the complexity of the receiver. And this type of complexity of the receiver is alright for the point-to-point communication, where the cost of the transmitter and the receiver are almost same. But in case of the broadcast communication, one station transmits the signal and several hundreds or thousands receive the same signal. So the cost of the receiver has to be lower for the broadcasting system. So for a broadcasting system, it is economical to have a one expensive transmitter with a simple and the less expensive receivers. So to reduce the receiver cost, the carrier signal can also be sent along with the modulated signal, so that there is no need to generate it locally at the receiver end. So this type of modulation is known as the double sideband with carrier modulation, or conventionally it is known as the amplitude modulation. So in the next video, we will talk about this amplitude modulation in detail. But I hope in this video, you understood the double sideband suppressed carrier type of modulation. So if you have any question or suggestion, Do let me know here in the comment section below. If you like this video, hit the like button and subscribe the channel for more such videos.